was peace. And the world had an even tenor to its way. It seems to me that the disaster about to occur was the event that not only made the world rub its eyes and awake, but woke it with a start. To my mind, the world of today awoke April 15th, 1912. Jack Thayer, Titanic survivor.
Attended a Christmas party with my girlfriends, and Eunice, as you know, at these parties we are not to let our interest in gentlemen known.
Sure.
That it would not be proper, his mother would say. And at this party I met two fine gentlemen, Thomas Andrews Jr. and Henry Holland. I recall it as yesterday, and I tell you I found nothing wrong with having the interest of two gentlemen. But mother begged to differ.
Thank you. Thomas Jr., you were quite a flirt.
Yes, indeed. Indeed. As time went by and both gentlemen were courting me, mother had said, Nellie, until you decide which gentleman who will court you, I shall lock you in your room upstairs at Conway. Can you imagine? Until I decided. Well, the decision was easy. Thomas Andrews Jr., of course. The times he would come over to mother's to see me. Well, as you know, the garden's there. Not too far from the home, you can go about with bushes, as I said, as high as 9-10 feet tall, and no one should see you. There we would steal a kiss, and he would sing to me, let me call you sweetheart. When he would come over to mother's, and he would sing to me, I had it quite timed, if you will, as I knew within a short period of time, moments, mother would send the gardener out to see if her Nelly should need anything. Of course, only to see what we were doing. So I assure you, if you ever were to take a walk with Edward, be aware, the gardener would come out in a short period of time. I recall when I found I was expecting Elba. You know the elation as mother, as a mother.
Yes.
Thomas took me to the yard, and overhead was Halley's Comet.
Really?
High in the sky, you remember?
Oh, I do.
With the stars.
He told me about this.
Yes.
He said, you know, this is a very, very special omen about the birth of my daughter.
To see that high in the sky, and I believe you were on a voyage at the time.
I think so.
And I recall looking at that hall. It went up for eternity into the night sky. And I thought of how proud I am of him and his fellow workers that they can build something so magnificent. Indeed. About this time, more had been responsibility given to Thomas, because as I'm sure Edward told you, Mr. Carlyle retired due to some discrepancies regarding other matters at the yard with Mr. Peary. And more time given to Thomas to take care of things. It's very lonely, Eunice, when Tom is away.
So what was his feeling about the Titanic? I know he had a concern, didn't he, about the lifeboats?
My dear Eunice, each and every night I would watch him at his desk in his study. You know his study. I would see him passing his hand through his hair, frustration, as these new liners were going to be larger than anything anyone has ever seen. And of course, being larger, safety requisitions are being considered. 64 lifeboats he is offering, as well as Alexander Carlyle, suggesting that these should be aboard. And Mr. Ismay begs to differ regarding this. And he tells my husband that according to British Board of Trade regulation, at this point, they are meeting the standard. He told my husband he denied the 64 lifeboats, Eunice. 46th then, suggestion, denied. Mr. Ismay finally had said to Thomas that you will have 16 lifeboats, but I shall go one better. I shall give you 4 more boats, being collapsibles, 2 being emergency cutters. The regular lifeboats should carry about 70 full-grown men, as they were tested in Belfast at just that. And the emergency cutters, 2 of them only being able to take 40 people. All this for a ship that can carry 3,200 at full capacity.
Absolutely ridiculous. Now, did you go to see him off?
No, dear. I remember it was April 2nd. I did not feel well about this at all. Not only to be facing 26 days alone, Elva and I, without Thomas. I recall him putting his things together in his study. I thought to bury my head in my pillow, as if that would take it away. And when he was ready to leave, he came to me at my bedside, and he said, "Nellie, it's time for me to go." Eunice, I did not move. I buried my face in that pillow, and I heard him descend down those stairs. When I heard him practically reach our front doors, then I ran to him. I met him at the front door, and there he took my arm, my hand, and he put it over my heart. And he said, "Nellie, this is where I shall always be. I shall be home soon." I was strong, very, very strong for him, and he for me. I saw the carriage take him away. Time is going by each and every day, and I'm still waiting. The last cable I had from him was on April 11th. I wish to share it with you. The team has had a very easy time of it, as the ship has been performing splendidly. We are expecting a smooth and uneventful crossing. I will telegraph you upon my arrival in New York. Ever your loving Thomas. To our family. Cable from White Star Line President Bruce Ismay on the rescue ship Carpathia to my father-in-law, Thomas Andrews Sr. at Ardara, of which you are familiar. April 16th, 1912. Have so far received names of about 200 survivors from Titanic. So far, the name of my friend Andrews has not been included. Much fear his sense of duty was so great that there is now scarcely any hope of his having been saved. His name. Oh. Cable from White Star Line President Bruce Ismay. New York City, April 18th. Carpathia docked. Deeply regret. Andrews reported missing. Ismay. Eunice, on the 19th of April. To Thomas Andrews Sr., my father-in-law. Telegram from his mother's cousin. She had spoken with survivors in New York, searching for news of my husband. Telegram read as follows. Interview, Titanic's officers, all unanimous that Andrews heroic unto death, thinking only of the safety of others, extend heartfelt sympathy to all.
Oh my God.
April 25th. 1912. My own dearest second mother, I cannot speak, but I can only write and tell you that my whole being yearns for my darling, and my heart just aches and aches for you and my dear second father who have been so loving to us. If you only knew the love and admiration I have for you both and for my brothers and sisters at Ardara and Maxwell Court, that you should all have such an awful sorrow seems just too cruel beyond words. Your mutual love and devotion for each other richly deserved that you should all be spared to each other for many, many years. For you are indeed united. For you are indeed the most united circle. I'm so sorry, I can't even speak. I have ever known. I think I know your pain, but oh, Aunt Lizzie, dear, we must not despair. Dear old Tommy could not bear to see anyone suffer, especially those he loved. His dear big heart was so tender to all who were in any trouble, and now that he cannot come back to us, let us cling the closer to each other and the little sweetheart baby girl he has left us. If there was anything that love or sympathy could do for you all, I would do it. When I come to you, I want you to feel absolutely free to speak of him, or not as you may wish, whichever you really feel will help you most. My fondest love to you, dearest Aunt Lizzie and Uncle Tom.
How beautiful.
Ever your loving Nellie.
Oh, Nellie.
My husband.
Oh, your dear husband.
And my dear, dear Nellie.